This is a good recording, man.
Yeah,
I can dig it.
Solid. Right on.
Good morning and welcome to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. That's 844-967-2789. You can text us at that same number. Good morning to you, Calvin. I see you made it.
Yeah, I'm in one piece, but they are definitely rough out there.
Oh, man. It's Friday, so that means my co-host Sandy Williams is with us. Hey, good morning to you, Sandy. How you doing?
Well, I'm okay, and I didn't make it. I mean, I'm doing it from my house here, but I guess the weather's bad.
It's worse than bad, and I think I'll be coming back home on Blue Mound. You know, I'm not going to take the 94 with the parking lot. And there were so many accidents on 94. You know, when you're driving and the snow is accumulating, Sandy, so rapidly, and the wind is blowing, and you can't see the road, then it certainly does not make any sense for you to be driving 50 miles an hour. Your tires aren't even touching the road.
And yeah, well, why would anyone who lives in Wisconsin know how to drive in snow? Oh, wait a minute. That's right. They should know how to drive in snow. But, I know. People forget. It's like, what the hell? You just were doing this last year.
Well, you know, Sandy, it's not even so much that they forget. So here we are. We've got a parking lot. And nobody's going anywhere. And that emergency lane that is supposed to be for emergency vehicles in case of a situation like this, there are people driving down the emergency lane because, Sandy, of course, they've got somewhere they have to be. The rest of the thugs.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, they're important people. Everyone else is.
And it frustrates you because you're wondering, man, if only we could figure out the license plates of all those loonies driving in the emergency lane. And then the police, I mean, the state patrol people who have to come down that emergency lane to get to the accident, Sandy, they're blocked in by people who are in the emergency lane.
Yeah, it's a day for citizen arrest.
Yes, it clearly is, and I wish I was in a position to do something about it. It really ticked me off, you know. And then the other thing is there's one lane open, so everything's filtering into one lane. If you're all the way in the lane on the right, Sandy, and the open lane is the one open lane is the one on the left, you certainly in the furthest lane on the right, it's going to be a while before you can filter all the way in to the one on the left, unless there's some drivers who are so terrified they let these guys come all the way from that lane on the right.
Well, that's when you use that gear on your transmission that says L. That L is L for leap. And R is for run. I forget what they stand for.
Anyway, man, it looks like they were absolutely right in what's coming, Sandy.
Yeah.
It's going to be massive. It's going to be massive. But anyway, you know, a lot to talk about, Sandy. How about them Bucks?
Unbelievable. Well, you know, they did catch the Celtics
at the right time.
Yeah, I mean, it was the third night in a row, I think, for the Celtics in three different cities.
Was it the third?
I think it was, yeah.
Well, you know, I had said it didn't matter. I didn't know anything about that, but I had predicted the Bucks would win that game because they absolutely had to have that game, whether or not the Celtics would have been playing three nights in a row, that you were going to get the best of the Bucks.
Yeah, I mean, the Bucks were really aggressive on defense, and the Celtics were cold as ice in the beginning. So, you know, I don't know whether it was our defense that was causing them to be so cold or whether they just couldn't sink a basket, but it was pretty lopsided. So lopsided that the network that was carrying it nationally switched to another game.
Well, the Bucks were up by 38 points at halftime, Sandy.
Yeah.
Do you think the Celtics might remember that?
Oh, I think so. And they pulled their starters. I mean, they didn't pull the starters.
Well, yeah, at halftime, but the Bucks didn't pull their starters until, you know, going into the fourth quarter.
Right.
But look, let's talk about U.S.-led coalition strikes Iran-aligned Houthi militants in Yemen.
Yeah.
Sandy. You and I talked about this somewhat. Certainly what the Houthis were doing, they claim in response to Israel and the Palestinians, or Israel and Gaza, hitting these, interfering in the lanes, the shipping lanes, was always going to be an issue. And so the United States last night, along with their partners, some partners, hit back and did some major damage. Now, is it not much to worry about, or do you think that this thing escalates?
Well, I don't know. The Houthis complain that claim that they've got 100,000 people in their military capable of participating in a military adventure, and their response to this was, "Well, we're gonna take our 100,000 people and join up with the Palestinians." Now, you know, if you look into the history of the Houthis and what's been going on there, I mean, there's been sort of a battle over control of Yemen for a number of years. The Houthis represent the Shia contingency who are anti-Saudi Arabia, very stridently anti-Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia neighbors Yemen and has sort of tried to cast its cloud over Yemen. Periodically, the Saudi Arabia, along with Western support, has tried to install in Yemen a Western sympathizer. And the Houthis most recently managed to throw that person out. And so the Houthis control the western shore of Yemen and the Red Sea portion of it. I don't know whether Iran would be interested in supporting them in getting immersed in Israel itself. And the problem with the Middle East is that the leadership always speaks in hyperbole. You know, they talk about doing things that they aren't going to do.
Right, aren't capable of doing.
Well, yeah, and they sort of beat their breasts. So my guess is that they won't, that they should have expected that when they started attacking shipping from Maersk and other of the international shippers that were going through the Suez Canal, that the West would join forces to defend the Suez Canal and access to it, because it's an important commercial place.
Sandy, it is a harrowing time. Is it safe to say that that we're certainly in a time frame where, you know, things could easily, we're in a slippery slope, and things could easily escalate where we find ourselves engaged in something major?
Well, yeah, we are. I mean, I think that. And it's mainly because we no longer have the ease of the Cold War, where there were one set of good guys and one set of bad guys, and the world divided, and it was easy to understand. Every decade since the collapse of the Soviet Union, international affairs has gotten more complicated because it's become more fractionalized. So we have in the Middle East, the Middle East, you know, we used to simplify it in our minds and think of it all as one big Arab area, but the fact is it isn't. And there are all kinds of schisms groups potentially at war with one another, the Kurds, the Shias, the Sunnis. You know, it's we can watch ISIS as it was taken on by Syria. You know, so it's complicated. And people who want to simplify it, who want to suggest that the United States, by exercising its muscle, can keep all of this, tamp all of this down and keep it from happening, are just wrong.
So, Sandy, who do we go to war with? I mean, the Hutus, you know, it's not like they're a nation. And so when we say that we're possibly going to go to war with the Hutus, you know, I mean, where do you begin? Where are they located? You know?
Yeah, well, the Houthi are, in fact, one of the things that's happening right now is that Saudi Arabia is negotiating to try and reach an agreement with to have relations, diplomatic relations with Iran. And part of that diplomacy and part of that discussion is the possibility that Saudi Arabia will recognize the Houthis as the actual government of the northern and western Yemen. And that would legitimize them. But right now they are just an insurrectionist group in Yemen. And so that does make it difficult. But even if they were the government of Yemen, I think it gets harder as these countries get smaller and things are more fractionalized for the United States to put its troops on the ground. And it all becomes something much more like Ukraine, where we decide who it is that we're going to support with missiles and armaments. And all of that gets more difficult and more complicated the more situations we're trying to deal with.
So let me ask you, Sandy, as all of these things ramp up and an election, a presidential election, you know, this year, clearly all of these things collectively can be an albatross. Is it safe to say that around?
Well, yes. And I just was reading, I read an opinion piece in Fox News. And of course,
Sandy, hold a thought.
Yeah.
First off, I have to say, hey, Calvin, is there anything you can do about preventing Sandy from reading an opinion piece on Fox News?
I think that's out of my pay grade.
844-967-2789. My friend, we'll let you respond on the other side. I've been there. I've done the exact same thing. All right.
On a revolution, well, you know, we all want to change the world. You tell me that it's evolution, well, you know, we all want to change the world. But when you talk about destruction, that you can count me out. Don't you know it's gonna be alright? Alright.
Alright, welcome back to the Earl Ingram right. Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. It's Friday, that means Friday's my co-host Sandy Wins. And Sandy, I didn't mean, you know, I mean, it's not like I don't read Fox or watch Fox News myself. It was mild attempt at humor, but go ahead.
No, God, no. It's a horrifying thing to do. It's horrifying. It was like the whole thing was premised on concepts that had little to do with factual. You know, I kept wanting to do the fact check to get behind it, but the fact is that a primary argument that's going to be coming from the opponents to Biden as he runs for election is that all of this stuff wouldn't have happened
right.
If Donald Trump had been president, which of course is a negative you can't prove. It's a it's an unprovable concept, and it's an undisprovable concept as well. But I'm confident that, for instance, Trump had put all of his eggs in the basket of Netanyahu, and Netanyahu was in power, and what happened in Israel happened with Netanyahu on the watch. And I don't think there's any connection that could have been made with the notion that Donald Trump in power in the United States would have kept it from happening, or that the United States would have been expected to do anything more powerful in response to it. And you know, and just yesterday we had this attack that was approved by Biden, which is probably going to cause get some criticism from the left.
It already has. It already has.
Which, you know, because, you know, the presidential powers to do such things unilaterally keep getting tested and strained. But, you know, I don't think there's any notion that that Joe Biden has a weaker hand on the wheel. If anything, he's been more militant and had a reaction that's been more rigorous vis-a-vis Ukraine than would have been expected from Trump, or than and now with respect to the Houthis in Yemen. So,
well, you know, Biden has always been a hawk. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. Well, no, I mean, but yeah, you're right. He's been a hawk, but the fact is that it's easy to say, well, anything that happens that's bad wouldn't have happened the other guy had been in power. There's no basis for that.
We hear that every time we're on. Let's go to the phone lines and David from Mequon. Good morning to you, David. You say what?
Good morning, gentlemen. You know what? I've said this repeatedly to both of you for quite a while now. I think we really are in the beginning stages of having the Third World War. And the reason why I say that is if you look at the overall larger actors involved with this and who is, you know, like as we've already talked about the proxy war end of things, where we're supplying a tremendous amount of military might along with Europe in general to Ukraine. That's number one. I think Norway they just are giving Ukraine, what, 16 F-15 jets? What do you think they're going to do with those? They're going to use that against Russia. They're going to bomb the crap out of Russia. And what I worry about, so if you look back to the Second World War.
Let's just talk a minute about world wars and what it is that defines them, because it's being used now as sort of a boogeyman declaration. But first of all, the F-15s that are being given, my understanding is that they're being restricted to being used over Ukraine territory. And so far, Ukraine has more or less abided by the restrictions we've imposed on them with respect to the use of armaments in Russian territory. I think that what's going on is the intention is with these fighters to use them to avoid Russian air superiority over Ukraine, okay, which is a far different thing than just assuming that they're going to be used to, as you say, bomb the crap out of Russia. There's been very little of that. The most recent attack was on Volgograd. Volgograd's about 60 kilometers, meaning 36 miles from the border of Ukraine, and it's an oil depot. So, you know, I think we can, you know, to use terms like World War III begs the question of, first of all, what is a World War III? And secondly, why do we think that Ukraine having fighter planes is going to be the beginning of World War III? Russia itself has been quite restricted in the way it's used things. I mean, my sense is that both sides are doing what's necessary to avoid it turning into that.
I would like to respond to that. So in regards with that, the reason why, and maybe this is where you and I totally disagree with what actually is happening. If you look at Russia is coalescing with Russia, Russia is also coalescing with North Korea. You look at Iran, they're trying to bring them into the mix. And if you look at Germany originally started, you know, the Second World War on their own. Then they end up getting Mussolini, you know, in Italy. And then
hey David, we don't have time to go through the history. Okay, so go ahead.
But my point is, And then Japan, of course, was joining the Axis back then. And you see the same combination happening today, slowly but surely. Putin and Xi have been, you know, shaking hands quite a bit, making deals, trying to figure out how we're going to trade technologies and everything else. And they have a much different idea of the way they want to see the world. And I think, you know, Sandy, you may disagree with me, but it doesn't happen overnight. It's been progressing.
Hey David, let me ask you a question. Is there a law against Russia and China coalescing? I mean, America has all sorts of allies. Is that such an alarming thing that we can't, that we should somehow have an intervention to stop Russia and China from coalescing?
Well, and let's just say that the reason for it, first of all, these two are natural enemies, not natural allies. And the main reason for what looks like coalescing right now are the sanctions we've imposed on Russia. China's decided not to recognize the sanctions, and therefore Russia has become the biggest purchaser of domestic automobiles from China in the world. Okay, it's the biggest customer. It's happened overnight. It's happened because the Western sanctions shut down all of the Western automobile manufacturing in Russia and embargoed the importation of them to Russia. And so, you know, much of what's happening with respect to what we call coalescence is just people we have tried to corner. Iran. We have sanctioned Iran to the point where the only people they can deal with are the people who don't recognize the sanctions.
So, Sandy, hang on. David, hang on. We'll carry it over after this short hiatus, and I think it's an important enough conversation. Tom, I see you will incorporate you as well. 844-967-2789. At 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. It's Friday. It means Fridays with my co-host Sandy Williams, and we. Go ahead, Sandy.
Let me just.
Let me say this to the listening audience.
We're
talking about you know, the retaliation by the United States and some of our allies on the Houthi militants in Yemen on last night, and whether or not this is ramping up, what may wind up to be something very serious this coming year. And Sandy and I, we've got David on from MechOne, who seems to think that we're headed into World War III. And Sandy, you were saying.
Well, I just wanted to kind of redirect, because I found myself falling into the kind of habit of being reactive to what David was saying. And instead, I think what we should do is, because we don't know, it's we're looking into a crystal ball, what's going to be in the future. And we do know that we've got lots of hotspots in the country, in the world. And we do know that those hotspots are getting related to one another to some extent because of the sanctions we're imposing and we're pushing people right into one another's arms. But we do have, for instance, North Korea probably providing arms to Russia. We have Iran providing missiles and things to Russia relating to Ukraine. We have Russia in the position to provide technology to North Korea and to Iran. So, you know, we are creating a bit of a bigger scale opponent. So my question, not with respect to Dave, is, okay, if you think that we're headed to World War III, what should we be doing? You know, what is the proper response of the United States going forward, if that's your prognosis?
All right. So to answer your question, Sandy, I would ask you to do me a favor, and Calvin can put the article up for you. It's from the Center of European Policy.
No. We don't.
I just want to know. I just want to know what you think. I'm not questioning anymore your assumption that we're headed towards that we've got these bad actors lining up with each other and potentially perform. My question is, what should America's reaction be today if your assumption or the assumptions in that article you want me to read are correct?
It's not assumptions. It's from December 1st. They show, they laid out exactly.
I don't care. Dave, I don't care. Let's just take whatever the facts are that they lay out. Fine. What should America's policy be going forward, given whatever it is that you're looking at or thinking about?
This is not even American policy. This is about a couple of superpowers getting together to try to throw.
Dave, stop.
Sandy, that's okay. Dave. We've got other callers. Thank you very much for the call.
Well, let me just say that with respect to, this is what we end up doing. We end up arguing about factual situations, and instead of arguing about policies that we should be implementing because of those factual situations, because what's happening now is that these factual situations are being described, and then they're saying, but these things wouldn't have happened if Donald Trump was president. Right. I mean, as far as I can tell, that's as far as the opponents get when they start talking about such things, and I don't understand that logic.
All right, let's go to Tom from L.A. Good morning to you, Tom. Thank you for hanging on. You say what, sir?
Good morning, Earl. Good morning, Sandy. First off, go Pack Go on Sunday. Second, we, the people, ultimately are the government, and we must never forget that. What we need more in this world is we need more democracy and less authoritarians. And America, wake up. Realize that the more authoritarians you get, the less government you get, the less we the people government you get. And then you have these breakoff groups and these terrorist groups and all these other people that are not legitimate governments. And then you don't know who the enemy is, unfortunately. Sandy, I'd like you to riff a little bit on the Budapest Accord, because that was one of the reasons why we did get involved in Ukraine in the first place after doing some research on it, in that, originally Ukraine, dropped all of their military might and
nuclear
bombed. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, what the Budapest Accord was, essentially both Russia and the United States were paranoid about a corrupt country like Ukraine, as corrupt as it was in the early 90s, having all of the nuclear arsenal that was located there under the aegis of the Soviet Union. And so there was a negotiation which resulted in the Budapest Accord, in which Russia and the United States agreed that those nuclear weapons would be given to Russia, actually, taken out of Ukraine. And both Russia and the United States agreed that they would protect the sovereignty of Ukraine in response to that.
So Tom, I wasn't looking to focus on any individual war. I was looking to focus on the fact that, you know, all of these things collectively, what's going on in Israel, what's going on in Ukraine, what's going on, what's getting ready to happen, all of those things collectively, and what those things will mean.
Because of these authoritarian leaders. It's happening because Benjamin Netanyahu wants to stay out of jail. It's happening because Donald Trump actually uses Russia and these people as their bankers and Saudi Arabia. I really give Joe Biden a lot of credit because what he's doing is actually unpopular with his progressive left base. I would like to say I'd like to see us go back to the Smugly Butler type of policy, which was there was no profit being made off of war. And let's see what would happen then if all of a sudden nobody could be making profit off of these arms and off of war, because I think we would see a lot less war and a lot more communication. But I do give Joe Biden credit. I am happy that he is our president, because I feel more safe and secure with this guy than I would to someone that's just going to give the keys to the kingdom, for the next thing that he can actually grift on the American people and try to make money.
Hey, Tom, thank you very much for the call. Let's go to CJ. CJ, go ahead.
Well, yeah, certainly don't look back to see what got us here, Sandy. Started with they're sensing weakness all over the world. Don't focus on what caused us. Peace through strength. That's not Joe Biden's plan.
Well, CJ, clearly, man, you the platitudes, you know, this is happening because we've been weak. The United States has never shown any weakness. Our military might is on display, and it has been, whether it is a Democrat or a Republican. The world knows, the world is aware. They don't say, well, okay, America's weak because Joe Biden is there. They know the military might and power of our nation. And every time you call and say that we're showing weakness because of one man, it's folly.
Really?
Yes.
Okay. Well, now we've got oil tankers that have been seized. You know, you can have a wish list. This is all underneath one president. You can say it's happened somewhere else. It didn't. It's underneath this weak, butchered president.
Hey, Sandy, can you help me remember? Because I don't, you know, my memory is not as well. But when Donald Trump was president, when those tankers were held up in the suit, was it not the
Suez? Yeah, well, the Suez Canal got jammed up.
Yeah, was Donald Trump the president then?
Yeah, he was president then, but that had to do with an accident as well. Yeah. But it's really just a coincidence. You know, it all depends. You know, you can try and attribute cause to coincidence, or you can describe coincidence and cause, but. The fact is that the response of the United States to all of the situations that have arisen has been extreme power, to the point where the Republicans want to pull in their horns. The Republicans are now saying, pull in your horns in Ukraine. We're not prepared to do the powerful things that you're asking for. And so, you know, I'm just not sure that it's fair to describe a partisan difference, or the notion that this stuff wouldn't have happened under Donald Trump. Like I said, it's a negative you can't disprove. It's a fine thing to say. The question is whether it's credible.
Go ahead, CJ. CJ? All right. Thank you very much for the call. You know, Sandy, you get to a point where these these are serious, serious issues. They certainly, at a time of a presidential election, these things, there are progressives who are speaking out against this attack last night. They're saying that the president of the United States does not have unilateral authority or power to do these things without coming to Congress. I don't know who's right. In that situation, the United States government believes, or the president of the United States believes, he has the authority and the power to do it because he did it. Congress is now, a progressive Congress, people are saying, no, he did not have a right to declare to do this unilaterally. We've seen this done unilaterally by other presidents before, haven't we?
Well, we have, but the unilateral power of the president, it depends on who's the president, whether you like it or not, right? So I think that there should be a basic political interest in the powers of the presidency, because who inhabits the presidency can change from year to year. We've noticed this with stark reality over the past 10 years. So I do agree that the power of the presidency needs to have constraints and particularly with respect to it, the ability of the president to get the United States into warfare. And unfortunately, for the last 50 years, ever since the Tonkin Resolution, which was the beginning of extreme presidential powers that allowed LBJ to get us heavily involved in Vietnam,
right.
Ever since that time, the power of the presidency to take actions militarily has become quite unfettered. And when you look backwards in time, we can wish that maybe it was a bit more fettered.
Yeah, you know, Sandy, all of these things that are happening simultaneously certainly warrant us being awake as a nation. And sometimes I'm kind of afraid that we are not awake as a nation during these times, and we could wind up in something major before we become awake. And that's my fear. If we can see these things coming ahead of time, if you and I can be the town crier or the warners of what, you know, we see, you know, it's one of the reasons why you and I spend this kind of time and dialogue talking about these issues, because you don't hear it in many instances in many other places. And I'm always honored to be able to have you and hear your points of view on these things, because these are serious, serious issues in this nation that have to be discussed, and they have to have priority. At least all the other things that we do in this nation won't matter a hill of beans if we wind up with ourselves in a horrible situation that is going to dictate resources from all these other things. Got to take a short hiatus. 844-967-2789. Sandy, when we come back, I want to talk about Lloyd Austin. We'll be right back. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number as we flash back to the early 1960s. It's Friday. That means Friday's my co-host, Sandy Williams. Let's go to Wisco Paul. Good morning to you, Wisco Paul. You say what, sir?
Good morning, Earl and Sandy. Hey, I just wanted to say, respond to CJ a little bit here. It's nice you guys let him talk every day. But you have to remember one thing about Trump. He will never do anything that does not benefit him. He doesn't care about the American people. I mean, he's on record. And he's just, at this point, trying to stay out of jail. But Biden is trying to do what's best for the whole country, whether you're Republican, Democrat, or Independent. I mean, he's trying his darnest. He inherited a mess. CJ will disagree with that, but it was a mess. And I wish the Democrats would focus more on everything that Joe has done good, the president. And that's my take today. Trump will never do anything but what benefits Trump himself.
Hey, so you guys have a great day.
Hey, Whisker Paul, thank you. Thank you very much for the call. So, Sandy, Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin had a procedure, prostate cancer procedure. He went in the hospital. He had emergency surgery done. He didn't inform the president, the White House, of the fact that he had this surgery done. And there are people calling for him to be fired. That what he did was so egregious. Help me understand, or help us understand. Clearly, one individual, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, is not controlled solely by one guy, is it, Sandy? I don't know.
No, the chain of command is the president to the Joint Chiefs, and the Defense Secretary does not stand between the president and the Joint Chiefs in terms of the line of power. Obviously, the Defense Secretary is a person who is put in that position because they are respected for their savvy opinions, and so it, you know, that's an important secretary position. And I have no doubt that in a business, someone who made themselves, who became unavailable and gave no notice that they might be in a position where they'd be unavailable would be chastised for it. And I think that Austin has been chastised for it. I think the White House has said we can't let that happen again. Well, you know, the notion that that's grounds for impeachment or firing, like is being talked about in Washington, strikes me as silly. You know, it would only be the case that if someone should be fired for that, if it much like Jair Alexander, when the answer was, well, it wasn't just the one thing, right? So if it isn't just the one thing about Austin, then, you know, maybe this is the straw that breaks the camel's back. But I'm not aware that he's been subjected to any sort of broadside criticism.
What I would ask you, Sandy, is a man in that position that they think enough of to put him in that position, right?
Yeah.
You would think then that they had confidence enough in that man that he's there. And so, you know, there are even Democrats who are saying, well, he should be dismissed. And I'm saying, well, okay. And then they're using this rationale. Well, I guess we were looking to retaliate against the Houthis, and he wasn't around for them to plan out what it was they did. This is how they found out. And so they're frustrated because of that.
Well, like I said, you know, it's a management decision as to whether, and my sense is that you wouldn't dismiss someone for one mistake unless it was contributing to a pile of mistakes. So I don't know the background behind that, but
right.
My reaction to it was there's a kind of a mountain out of a molehill. They started looking at, you know, the time that Dwight Eisenhower, they covered up the fact that he had a heart attack. Well, he's not the president. You know, if the president did such a thing, I think there'd be real grounds for extreme criticism. But I have a little more problem with the mountain that's being made out of this.
Yeah. I mean, Sandy, the way I looked at it was kind of the same thing. If you've got enough confidence in this man, he didn't, as the attorney for Donald Trump said the other day, Donald Trump didn't kill anybody. Well, you know, Lloyd Austin didn't kill anybody. For heaven's sakes, you know, he had a serious procedure done.
Well, you know, Donald Trump had a parade of defense secretaries. you know, we'd be hard pressed to name all of them if we sat down for a second to try and come up with a list.
844-967-2789. It's Friday. It means Fridays with my co-host Sandy Williams. You can join us 844-967-2789.